Ofelio, dumo serca mego, kocham ciebie z uczucia szczerego. O!
Doskonale, towarzysze. Teraz, Andziu, ty mu odpowiadasz.
No, Andziu.
Oj, Hamlecie mój, ty najśliczniejszy. Ja cię kocham tysiąc razy więcej.
O, Ofelio moje, ty jagniątko. Miłaś ty mi.
Welcome back to On the Move. I'm Dan Brenner, your host, and our program today, which takes a look generally about things going on and on the move in Hollywood, is about film in Eastern Europe. And our guests today are representative actor and actress from Eastern Europe, now making their home here in Los Angeles. We just saw our first guest, Beata Poźniak, in a scene from Polish television version of Hamlet, and also joining us today, Oleg Vidov, from originally from the Soviet Union, now makes his home here in Los Angeles as well. Both actors and film and television in their respective countries, and here in Los Angeles too. That was a scene from a sort of a Hamlet, right?
Well, sort of, yes. It's not Hamlet by Shakespeare, it's Hamlet by Yugoslavian writer Ivo Brešan. Mm-hmm. And it takes place in Yugoslavia. So it's a kind of a comedy, but a political comedy. This film actually was a few years on shelves, and I just saw it a few months ago for the first time. It was a really interesting experience to see it, to see something that was filmed many years ago.
You've been acting in Los Angeles for about 2 years, mm-hmm. but have been on the international scene for a little longer, although you continue to work in Poland.
Well, actually, not really.
No?
More or less in Europe, yes. If there would be some interesting project, I mean, in Poland, I would go. But I worked for many years in Poland, and I wanted just, I needed a challenge, so I guess that's why I came over to New York first and then to Los Angeles.
You do some modeling here too. I think we have some mm-hmm. Pictures of that kind of work. Now, is there a large number of Polish models in, is that a field somebody can go in and make a living if they
in
were
Poland?
In Warsaw? Yeah.
No, there's nothing like this. You see, everything is run by the government, so we mm-hmm. don't have commercials. We don't have any kind of to advertise something, clothes or anything like this. I mean,
yeah.
For the first time this year, with all the changes in Europe, I mean, in Poland, for the first time we had like Pepsi Cola ads, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So,
how did you figure that modeling would be one of the things you would do?
Well, actually,
or you fell into it?
No, what happened was, I would like to explain this. When I came here to Los Angeles, I came here with Andrzej Wajda's film Chronicle of Love Affairs,
mm-hmm.
and I had this spread in Movie Line magazine just because I was the guest of the film festival. And when you are interviewed, they hire like a makeup person and you know, a designer.
Welcome
so
to
when
Los
I
Angeles.
Saw when I saw myself,
yeah.
I could not believe, you know, how I look. And after that, I mean, Movie Line was getting calls from like other people, like designers and
modeling agencies. And boom, you had another career.
And here I am, an actress, and now they're asking if I want to be a model.
So. Does that give you an insight or a perspective on American actors? I mean, in this country, while there are some who are serious. And stay in the theater, for example.
Mm-hmm.
Serious actors are viewed as those who somehow remain in the theater, or that's the place where serious actors go to do something serious.
Mm-hmm.
And then everything else, feature films particularly, and television shows, and modeling, or mm-hmm. product endorsements, become the way in which they make a lot of money.
Right.
Have you already adjusted to that view of acting, that part of it is very commercial and very money-oriented, and other part is serious? And
well, it's I'm trying to adjust myself. It's very different than in Poland. I mean, completely different world.
Yeah.
I mean, different planet completely.
Really?
I mean, in Poland, as you know, I mean, we don't have any agencies or casting directors, producers.
It's still more, it's a more centralized function.
A bit, yeah. Right.
And it, when you, you've been here in Los Angeles for, oh,
4 years.
4 years. In terms of your view of it, we've spoken before, I know that the most important thing is to work and not be viewed in a very narrow role as someone who can just play the role of the Soviet or Eastern European accented actor.
Right.
What's the biggest, what's the most daunting challenge in overcoming that?
My purpose, why I came here, I defected. Right. And I ran away as far as I could from the situation where I didn't want to be.
Yeah.
But when I came here, I met my friends and I met my fans, because a lot of emigrants who came here, they remember me. And they gave me some kind of support. They said, Oleg, you know, you'll make it, do it, go. You know, we believe in you. And it helped, you know. And certainly, step by step, from the beginning, I found my way.
Yeah.
Certainly very important to speak English properly. And when I will manage my English, you know, normally, then I will have wider opportunity.
For all kinds of parts.
For all kinds
of parts. Yeah, we were talking before the show, Basha, who's a popular recording artist here, who's who is originally from Poland, but we don't know when she left Poland, I guess, and you growing up in Poland, never, I guess, never heard of her until you came here.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, and she's very popular, and she's wonderful.
There's another television clip we have, a love scene that you did.
A love scene?
Well.
Oh my gosh.
No.
Well, from Camille Curran's life, what's that about?
Oh, wow. Well, that's actually based on a true story about a Polish writer.
Well, love can be true.
Right. So,
okay, well, let's take a look at this. Is a scene you did for Polish television?
For Polish television. Uh-huh. It was my debut.
Okay, well, this is now
in, let's in take this TV show. Actually,
great.
It was a series.
Let's take a look. But not necessarily steamy love scenes. Is that about
cut
as
in the right moment.
Is that about as hottest things get on Polish television?
Oh no, I think Polish television is really
freer.
Very free. It's actually surprising that here American television is more restricted. I mean,
prudish, would you say?
Yes, comparing to Polish television, yes. And I grew up with this kind of feeling that in America there's a lot of freedom, and so it was interesting when I came over here to see that it was different a little bit.
In terms of freedom, do you think that the freedom that is lacking here is a result of the commerciality of television? That is, if you did a scene that was more explicit than what passed here, that the advertisers would stay away from it in television, and that's why it's not so much a question of freedom, but what the commercial aspects of television dictate.
Well, it depends. I really don't know. I mean, if, for example, if in a part the character needs to be nude, but I'm against nude for the sake of nudity.
Right.
So it depends, you know, what kind of show it is and
Well, is nudity permitted on Polish television?
Yes, it is. It is. Hmm. And as I say, it's different because, I mean, it's different when a little boy sees a nude woman and it affects him.
Right.
And we've seen the other following scenes, you know, that he changed. It affected, you know, completely his psyche. And it's different when we just see a woman just showing off her body, you know. So that's why we have other, you know, X-rated films, I guess, for...
Yeah, and maybe
not we in Poland, mm-hmm. but we here
in the United States. We either objectify sex and give it an X rating so that people know what they're getting, or we exclude it from the rest of the mainstream stories that we tell mm-hmm. on television.
Right.
Although I guess that's changing because as commercial television faces competition from cable,
right.
which it mm-hmm. does allow, I think, a greater amount of freedom, artistic freedom, at least in this department.
Mm-hmm.
Broadcasting may change. Well, let's in the Soviet Union, frontal nudity. Is there any?
Now they begin to use it, a lot of it. But before, I don't think they could show it, you know.
Mm-hmm.
It was like in America in 1930s,
yeah.
you know. They could show women in the underwear, you know.
But not?
And they go somewhere and that's it. You know?
Yeah.
No sounds, no show, nothing.
Well, you made an awful lot of films before you defected to the United States. You were sort of the, one article described you as the Robert Redford of the Soviet Union during the heyday of your film days there. One of your more celebrated films, The Battle of the River Neretva, almost an epic film, I guess.
Yes. It was a huge co-production with Yul Brynner, Orson Welles, Hardy Krueger, Franco Nero,
mm-hmm.
all Yugoslavs, Sergei Bondarchuk.
Did it get much release in the United States?
It was nominated for the Oscar.
In foreign film?
Yes.
So it was playing primarily in art houses. It wasn't released in the...
I think it was in video.
Uh-huh.
But I don't think... I don't know because I wasn't here
right.
in that time.
And you weren't getting a... As a film actor in the Soviet Union, I wonder if this is true in Poland too. Did you receive a profit if the picture made a profit?
You don't. No, never in Soviet Union, never.
That's also true here in the United States for most actors. But mm-hmm. but at least the promise is that there's a chance for profits.
No, you are getting residuals.
Yes.
When you involve in the SAG, Screen Actors Guild movie.
Yeah.
Then you're getting residuals.
Well, residuals, and also if the picture's a big hit, sometimes one of the inducements for an actor
right.
is to maybe earn less. In the front end, and then you make some money.
Oh, certainly, you know, because in the Soviet Union, it was they never thought about the stars, you know, to raise the stars.
Right.
They had different system.
Although you were a star in the picture involving the Battle of River Neretva, so maybe we can take a look at it and see a little performance of
Oleg
Vidov.
Thank you.
Well, I guess that the river was acting up during some of the running of that.
A lot of explosions around,
right.
So it was like...
or the VCR machine.
Can you imagine? Yes,
you
that's
know?
It.
we were talking about freedom. Now that you've been here 2 years, do you mm-hmm. find yourself freer as a performer? Or do you find yourself more impelled by the commercial instinct?
Well, it's different. You see, in Poland, I was like brought up on... romantic characters, poetry,
mm-hmm.
Exploring the mystery of the soul, you know,
uh-huh.
it's completely different. And here, here I am, you know, I'm playing a district attorney, a tough woman, you know.
Uh-huh.
And now I'm, you know, like auditioning and for these kind of different women with, you know, that are handling a Smith Wesson or a 6mm Beretta, you know.
But you're not limited to roles of Eastern Europeans who are in the United States. Are you getting other kinds of...
Well, it's different. You know, sometimes I am auditioning like for German women or, yeah. from, you know, I mean, European women.
You're still European. Stuck because of the accent.
Definitely, yes.
Yeah. Over time, that may...
I hope so. I hope that will come back to times like, you know, Greta Garbo and the Bergman.
Well, there's an opening right now, Karen. but you're doing some modeling. I think we may have some photos of your modeling work, which
clips?
Which you know, oh. in this...
That's from recent Exposure magazine,
mm-hmm.
April, May issue.
Of Exposure May?
Yes, uh-huh. I was in that. They did a beautiful layout. And
that's and you know, in the United States, that can propel or launch a...
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting because I thought Exposure is mm-hmm. kind of domestic, but then I got a call from London the other day, and uh-huh. Exposure comes out also in London and Italy and just in France, so that was a surprise for me.
I don't know if you've been here long enough to know that some people become famous because they have one line in a commercial, and then, for, you know, the fellow who did the Federal Express commercial, who talked uh-huh. fast, could then mm-hmm. become a much in demand performer because of that.
Hmm.
So well, our fingers are crossed based on right. some of these pictures. You have done some recent work with the Disney Channel.
It was independent movie,
mm-hmm.
the Russian fairy tale.
Called Emerald Princess.
Emerald Princess.
Yeah, what's the story of?
Well, it's a story of the two American children who went into Russian fairy tale, and they helped to solve their problems because the Iron Dragon put the curse on that kingdom, and it was a critical moment, and if you know, they will not overcome, mm-hmm. you know, then they will be under the curse. So those children help to save the freedom.
Where was it? Was it shot here in
oh,
the
it's shot
States?
In Tarzana.
In Tarzana, well, that...
In the backyard
very,
of our...
very exotic location there.
Yeah.
Gateway to Simi Valley.
Okay. Right.
Well, I think we have a clip of this. And is this aired already, or is this coming up on Disney?
It's coming up on Disney Channel.
Okay, and with the way that that channel runs, it'll be you know repeated, I guess,
yes.
over the course of a year or so.
They bought it for 2 years.
Great.
So
well, let's take a look at it now. Okay. The Emerald Princess. Take a look.
How long we have slept?
It's the guards from Baba Yaga.
Good morning, Your Majesties.
Good morning.
It's very strange. The whole court is asleep. Except Yurka and Schlepper.
Oh my, Tsarevna. Tsarevna! Where is my brother's daughter, the Emerald Princess?
I promise you, I will find her, even if I have to search the whole earth.
That poor, beautiful child.
Be alert. Today we must save the princess and awaken the kingdom.
Yes, Your Majesty, Tsar Igor.
Guard the palace entrance.
Let's go to the Baba Yaga.
I'm afraid. Real heroes are never afraid.
Looks like a lot of fun.
Yes.
as you look at your home country, because when we think of Eastern Europe, we think not only of performers such as yourself coming to the United States for work and at one point more artistic freedom than you had in those countries, but those countries are changing very fast.
Mm-hmm.
So what might have been impossible a few years ago may very well be possible in the coming years if the trends in reform continue. From the flip side, Americans are looking at Eastern Europe, at your home countries, and saying, How can we exploit those markets for our films and our products? And for example, Time Warner has announced that they're going to open a multiplex theater in Moscow. Well, how do you think that's going to change?
I think it's very important. It's very important when in Russia, let's say, we were raised with American pictures. They were captured from Nazi Germany. The Germans bought those pictures from America. And now, when they were captured by Russians, they were shown all over the countries. And I remember when I was a child, they show Tarzan, they show many, many all those Fairbanks movies. So it gave us some kind of window into the world and gave some kind of wonderful attitude toward the United States and toward Hollywood.
Although they were, those films tended to be on the old side, on the sort of, Tarzan wasn't the most controversial film ever made.
Mm-hmm.
The more controversial films, or the more violent films, were the, they didn't get this, they, there were no way to release them in the Soviet Union.
You know, but it was the attitude, the personality, strong individual.
Yeah.
That was kind of against that kind of collective feelings. And the people appreciated it, and they were raised with those American movies, like Spartacus, yes. Seven, Magnificent Seven. So those movies, you know, gave some kind of attitude for the freedom, and that kind of information gives people a lot of information about the world, about the United States. That's why people in Russia, they really, I think, they know a lot about American literature, mm-hmm. American movies, about American character.
How about the competitive side? If I was a Soviet actor, mm-hmm. seeing that now all this Western product was going to come in, which, as you say, is very popular, has a cachet, mm-hmm. that the people like to see those pictures. Worldwide, they tend to be among the most popular mm-hmm. works in the world, American pictures. Do you think they're going to resent the fact that this once state-supported system for actors, where the actor had a pretty much guaranteed life, lifestyle, mm-hmm. income, some social prominence within the Soviet system, now going to be challenged by an influx of American films?
I don't think so. I think because in Russia, let's say, the actors should, you know, they, as usual, graduated university.
Mm-hmm.
They, film school, at theater school for 5 years. They have a huge competition, like 400, 500, 1,000 people for the place. For the place in this institute.
Yeah.
So you're starting during this time. You're raising your culture. You became part of the national culture and treasury.
Yeah, but now Ernest goes to jail, comes over.
Right.
And all of a sudden this high theatrical part of filmmaking mm-hmm. is, or dramatic and serious,
yeah, I know.
Is being overtaken by the just the pure popularity of these American films. These, you know,
I know it's in America, right?
Yeah.
But you know, you never know if
how it's
going to
play
go in Russia.
How will it play on the on the
because
Volga?
You know, specification of the national mentality. You know,
not play.
Yeah, it's,
Ernest
it
goes
could
to,
be.
Right, Ernest goes to jail and never comes back.
Yeah.
That'd be the Soviet version of it. I want to take a moment to talk a little bit more about what's happening for you in your career. We've seen you working in modeling, and you've done some video work. I think we have some more shots of some of your modeling work, which I guess are going to come up as we talk. But
okay.
What do you see as the brightest prospect for someone like yourself in this town?
Well, you know, I'm like looking for a challenge. So it could be film, television, theater, music video. So that's mm-hmm. something completely new for me because we don't have music videos as well in Eastern Europe. So I just finished working as a lead girl for a music video by a group, Hurricane.
Uh-huh.
I was really exciting. I was like kind of a moving statue and mm-hmm. melting in the floor and dancing with the curtains, and it was really kind of a very surrealistic dream. So that was very interesting. I really enjoyed working on that. That was a great...
I think we have a clip of that. Oh. The group is called Hurricane.
Hurricane, and the song is Next to You.
Next to You. Beata Pozniak, Next to You.
Down the street, they like to own you. They walk with you.
So we'll see how that plays on the streets of Warsaw when it gets over on Saturday. Sure. I'll bring it over. What is coming up for you?
Well, actually, I'm directing a show which is based on poetry, and this is with projections and flashlights and rappers. So I really enjoy working
here
on
in
that
town.
Here in town.
Great, and of course, theater and film and television as
film
as
and television
as
well,
it comes
yes.
along.
I'm really like into it. It's right now. I'm into. Like rediscovering the archetypes, like Joseph Campbell would say. So reading mythology and myths, and that's also in the poetry.
I suppose Hurricane is a little deviation from
no,
that.
No, it's completely something
well,
different.
It's got its own
I'm so
moment,
happy yeah. that, you know, I can come, you know,
you
just
do everything.
Taste
yeah,
those
that's great.
Different things.
Oh, you defected from the Soviet
right.
Union. Will you go back and work there ever?
I think, you know, now with a lot of new what happened in the Soviet Union, I think I will go, and especially now we're working on a script called Bear Hug. It's a romantic love story between Russian and American. So it's after several days we'll get the script, and I hope, you know, that at the end of the year we probably can begin this movie if everything will be fine. You know.
Will this be shot in Soviet Union or in Tarzana?
No, it will be shot. It will make in Moscow.
In Moscow.
And
as a co-production, perhaps with
co-production.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you know those people who really they were terrible. I mean, bureaucracy. They were out now. And the new generation
came. The people
came.
Who ran the Soviet film industry.
Right.
Yeah.
And I'm really glad that it happened.
Mm-hmm.
And that opened a lot of gates for our new steps. You know, I think
well,
it's
I think
great.
I think it'd be very exciting for someone like yourself who was a very big star in the Soviet Union to come back now into the new
it's really
world of glasnost. Yeah. And with your English, you'll be able to work in both productions.
Yeah, that's
exciting.
The wonderful yeah. side.
Well, Beata Pozniak, Oleg Vidov, thank you very much for joining us on this brief look at what's happening in Eastern Europe, both for Eastern European actors here and what may be going back from the United States there. And thank you very much for joining us. I'm Dan Brenner for On the Move. We'll see you next time.
Thank you.
Thank you.